are the hand that catches my fall. You are the friend that answers my call. You are my day. You are my night. You are my love. You are my life. You are the love I need. You are the air I breathe. You are my
I'm Steve Carr, pastor of Calvary Chapel in Arroyo Grande, and I'd like to welcome you to our program. Marriages and families are in great turmoil today in our country. I'm sure you would agree. But how is your marriage doing? What's going on behind the door of your home? Is your marriage in trouble? Have you given up hope, thinking there are no solutions to the conflicts between you and your spouse? I want to encourage you today that there are answers to these struggles. Where can you find these answers? I believe the one who created marriage knows how it works best. So please, get your spouse, get your Bible, and open your heart to God's truth today.
Ephesians 6 and verse 1. We're going to look tonight at the subject of children and parents, but specifically that of children. And now, the responsibility of a child is pretty simple here, laid out in just a few verses. But we want to look tonight in its entirety on this one particular subject. Read with me, verse 1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with you, and you may live long on the earth. And then next week, we're going to be looking at the father's responsibility. And you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord. And the reason why I read verse 4, even though we're not going to really cover that tonight, is that some of the study is going to kind of bleed into verse 4, but I really want to reserve the majority of addressing really the parental responsibility next week. I just really want you to consider the child's responsibility here. And yet, considering a child's responsibility, that is also a parent's responsibility, because a parent has to make sure that this is what is taking place in the home. And so just keep that in mind as we go through this particular text. So basically, there are two exhortations here to children. They are to obey their parents, and they are to honor their parents. And these two items are very similar, and yet they are very different, as you'll see as we get into the study. First, the word obey here is a very important word to understand. It literally means to heed authority from a willing heart. Anybody can bow without a willing heart. And that's not what he's talking about here. True biblical obedience is something that comes from the heart. And you'll see this as we get further along in this study. And so to heed authority from the heart, that really is what it's all about. Willingly. Now, that is a child's responsibility, but it is also the responsibility of a parent to make sure that you're doing everything in your power to bring that about. And so we'll look at how to do that. Now, why is heeding your parents' authority so important? And why is that something that you should be concerned about as a parent? Well, because it says in Proverbs 22, verse 15, foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child, and the rod of correction will drive it far from him. Now, the word foolishness here is a very general Hebrew word for sin, but it's all kinds of different types of sin. It is sometimes translated those who love mischief, those who are arrogant, those who are self-willed. And so what he's saying here is that self-will is bound up in the heart of a child. The love for mischief is bound up in the heart of a child. The arrogance and rebellion and every other sin that you can imagine is bound up in the heart of a child. And so the importance here of this exhortation is that a child learns to heed authority in his life, which primarily is his parent, mother, and father, and that heeding of authority is something that is willingly chosen to do. And so now the reason for this is that basically if a child does not learn to heed your authority, then they are very unlikely to heed the authority of God in their lives. They are very unlikely to heed the authority of their boss when they get a job after they leave your home. They're very unlikely to heed their teacher's authority. And so it is in every aspect of life, you have to heed authority. You have to submit. We looked at this particular topic when we looked at a wife's submission to her husband. And we looked at that issue that in all aspects of our life, male and female, we all have to learn to submit. It's a reality. We submit to the laws of the land. We submit to our bosses. We submit everywhere. And so it is an issue that has to be learned. What better place could it be learned than in the home? From the earliest childhood all the way up through teenage years into adulthood. So this is a really critical issue. The ultimate goal in all of your discipline and all of your instruction and all of what you do as a parent is ultimately to get them to heed the authority of God from the heart. That is your primary number one goal. That's what a disciple, a true disciple of Christ is. And that was my intention as I was raising my children from the beginning. I want true disciples of Christ to be raised in my home. And so that's ultimately what a disciple is, one who heeds the authority of God in their heart from a willingness of heart. Now, David never disciplined his son Adonijah. And this is probably one of the best examples of why a husband or father or mother should discipline their child, is because Adonijah basically rebelled. And he rebelled, the scripture says, specifically because he had never been disciplined. Think about this. It says in 1 Kings chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, "Then Adonijah exalted himself, saying, 'I will be king.' And he prepared for himself chariots and horsemen and 50 men to run before him." And notice in the parentheses here, "And his father had not rebuked him at any time by saying, 'Why have you done so?' And he was also very good looking." Interesting how the scripture lays this out. This man rebelled against his father, tried to destroy him and his own brother, and the will of God simply because he had never heeded the authority of his father. It's a very powerful truth. It says in Proverbs 19:18, "Chasten your son while there is hope, and do not set your heart on his destruction." So correct your son while there is hope. And while they're in your home, there is still hope. And that makes it very clear that there is a time when they will not be under your control, your authority, and it is then their choice that will make the difference. Proverbs 29:15, it says, "The rod and rebuke give wisdom, but a child left to himself brings shame to his mother." Notice, if you leave a child to himself, then shame is what he will bring to his parents. Interesting. And so he says here, the rod and rebuke. Very important here that he associates both these issues, the rod and rebuke, verbal reproof and discipline through the rod. Now we're going to deal with the rod and discipline next time. But notice that both of those items are clearly outlined. In Hebrews 12:9, it says, "We have had human fathers who corrected us, and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live?" So all through the Bible, in the Old Testament and New Testament, it makes it very clear that fathers primarily are to guide their children, to instruct them, to discipline them, to help them in a right path for their lives. Now, when I counsel with families, and I have, gosh, over the last 30 years being here, I have had couples say to me before things that just scare me. They say things to me like, "Well, I don't want to upset my child by disciplining them. I don't want to damage their self-esteem. I don't want to give them a negative view on life." And so basically they give them anything and everything that they want, which is probably the worst thing you could possibly do for a child. And so I just encourage people, you know what? Hey, you're not going to hinder their creativity. You're not going to damage their little psyche. You're going to, if you love them, discipline them, and teach them, if you just do all three of the things that are described here and which we're going to look at next week, you're going to turn out the best child possible that you could have. And yet that is not even a foolproof answer, which I will explain more next week as well. And so basically, how does a child learn to obey? This is critical. And this is, I think, is essential for any parent to understand. How does a child learn to obey? The first thing is that it begins with having a heart for the Lord. You know, without a heart for the Lord, your child will basically have no heart for obedience. They just won't have the heart for it. It probably is best seen in the difference between Jacob and Esau. In the Old Testament, in Genesis 28, verses 7 through 9, it declares there that Jacob obeyed his father when he went into Padan Aram, and he took a wife from his relatives there. He did not take a wife from the Canaanites. And it says there that Esau saw that the Canaanite women did not please his father Isaac. And so what did he do? He went out and married a Canaanite woman. The Canaanites were idolaters. And Isaac said to Jacob, "Go and don't take a wife from the people of the land here that are idolaters. Go back to those in our family that love the Lord."
and are committed to him. And so Esau basically said, hey, well, if this bothers Pop, then I'm going to do what just bugs him. I'm just going to do what he doesn't want me to do. And so you see this attitude in Esau's rejection of the birthright, being willing to sell it for a bowl of pottage, and he could care less about spiritual things. And yet Jacob wanted it. The way he got it wasn't the right way, but he did at least care about spiritual things. And he was willing to submit to the Lord when he came into contact with him. And so the difference between these two men, one had a heart for the Lord and ultimately turned out pretty good, did the right things. Didn't start out very good, but ended up good, much like many of us in this room. Didn't start out very good, but we ended up okay. And that's the grace of God, totally. But I think a real interesting example and emphasis of why a person's heart is so important. Solomon says in Proverbs 23, verses 12 through 16. Notice the emphasis here that Solomon places upon the heart of his son. He says, apply your heart to instruction. He said, and your ears to the words of knowledge. And then he says, do not withhold correction from a child. For if you beat him with a rod, he will not die. You shall beat him with a rod and deliver his soul from hell. My son, if your heart is wise, my heart will rejoice. Indeed, I myself, yes, my inmost being will rejoice when your lips speak right things. Is that not the desire of a father or a mother's heart? When they hear their son or daughter speaking right things, doing the right things, it just brings joy to your heart. Now, if any of you are a little bothered by that, if you beat him with the rod, he will not die, the word beat there means to strike lightly. So don't be offended. Don't write me a letter. Talk to the Lord about that. We'll talk about this issue more next week, about spanking and that whole issue. Where does that fit into discipline? It's only one part of discipline. Only one part. And we're going to look at all the forms of discipline that the Scripture gives. And yet, notice he says here, apply your heart. My son, if your heart is wise. You see, a wise heart, a heart that's after the Lord, is one that's going to apply the truths of God in their own life. And that's what Solomon was after. The second thing that it teaches a child to obey, and one that I think is essential to understand, is that obedience must come from the heart. So you have to have a heart for the Lord, and then obedience will come from the heart. It cannot be reversed. You have to have one before the other. That is why the training of a child is so important and focused on in verse 4. Dads, that is your responsibility. Train your children. Lead them into a relationship with the Lord, because that is what's going to enable them to obey from the heart. And so, obedience from the heart. Romans 6:17 says this. God says there through the Apostle Paul, he said, God be thanked that through you, though you were slaves to sin, yet you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine to which you were delivered. And so you have obeyed from the heart. Notice that term. You see, so Paul acknowledges that real obedience comes from the heart. It can't be an external thing. It must be an internal thing. We don't want behavior modification. If that's all you're interested in, getting your children to obey externally and not from the heart,
then that's all you'll get. And as soon as they leave your presence, they will do as they please. Because I guarantee you, that's what they're going to do. They're going to do what they want to do when they are out of your presence. So you hopefully are going to try and train them to heed God's authority in their life, to realize that they are creatures who have been created under the authority of someone a whole lot bigger than you, someone who loves them and cares for them. I think probably one of the best books that you could get on this subject of discipline and getting your children to obey from the heart is called Shepherding a Child's Heart by Ted Tripp. If any of you are parents looking for a great book, get this book. It's one of the best books I think I've ever read on child rearing, because he gets you to the issue. How do you get to your child's heart? Because that is where obedience is rendered. All behavior flows from the heart. In Matthew chapter 15, verse 19, Jesus said, out of the heart is where all behavior flows. He said evil thoughts, adulteries, murders, thefts, every behavior that comes from a person's life comes from their heart. So it really is essential that you focus on the heart first. Where is your heart at? I think that if you as a parent expose your child's heart issues, when you see a behavior that is not in accordance to obedience to you, you have to deal with that heart issue that is behind that disobedience. You see, there's a heart issue behind that behavior, because that behavior came out of their heart. So if you don't get at that issue in the heart, you are missing the point. You're missing the whole point. So one of the things that Ted Tripp does in his book is he says, ask the question, why? Why did you do that? Now, psychologists tell you, never ask the question, why? And that is just ridiculous, because Jesus asks the question, why, all of the time. Throughout the scripture, just look up the word why sometimes in your concordance. And Jesus said to his disciples, why is it that you have no faith? Why isn't that you don't understand this? Why is your heart in this place? Why are you doubting? Why are you fearful? Constantly asking them, why? Why does he ask them that question? To get them to examine their heart. Why am I doing this? Well, I don't know. That's usually the answer, right? And you say to him, that's not good enough. We're going to be sitting here a long time because we got to find out, why did you do this? Why did you say that? Why did you take that action? Because there's a reason. And if you don't get to the reason, then you cannot counsel the heart to bring it into a place of willing obedience, heeding the authority of God, and heeding your authority as well. And so don't put your goal as behavior modification. It's changing the heart. That's the business that God's into. That's what he wants you to be involved in, and helping your children do that. Obedience is aided in the heart by the Holy Spirit. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22, he says there, you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit. So when a child has a heart for the Lord, and then they choose to obey from the heart, it will be because the Holy Spirit is empowering them. Again, another great reason why you need to lead them into a personal relationship with the Lord from their earliest years, and encouraging that as often as you can. Thirdly, obedience is a learned experience. It's a learned experience. This is what the Bible teaches. In Hebrews chapter 5, verse 8, it says there, though he was a son, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. Through the difficult times that Jesus went through, even though he was a son, being fully man, he had to learn obedience. Now, I'm telling you, every child has to learn obedience. Every adult has to learn obedience. Every one of us in this room, we have been taught to obey. And how did we get taught to obey? How did we learn that? Well, by getting consistent correction and consistent instruction in the right path. Those two things. That is what a parent is responsible to do, is to correct the disobedience every time it's seen, and then to instruct in the right path that you should take. In Proverbs 4:11, this is what Solomon says again to his own son. I have taught you in the way of wisdom. I have led you in right paths. So he taught his son the way of wisdom, and he led his son through his example into those paths. And we'll look at example here in just a minute. So obedience, in fact, it's the only way obedience can be learned, is by you correcting disobedience and then consistently instructing what is the right path. And then fourth, obedience is a choice. Thus, a child needs to make a choice, a willing choice. Again, you can force children to do what you want them to do. You can manhandle them, which many times parents do. They scare them by going into a rage. They have all kinds of means. We're adults. We can, you know, intimidate. But it's not a willing choice that they have made. Now, I'm telling you, especially with teenagers, this is extremely an important issue. I used to say to my teens, look, this is what I think you need to do, but you know what? It's up to you. It's your choice. Because you know what? You're going to have to pay the consequences. You're going to have to pay the price if you make this particular choice. Because especially as a teenager, teens need to make their own choices. And they want to make their own choices. The problem is some of those choices aren't wise choices. Now, when you were a teenager in high school, did you make some bad choices? Oh boy, I'm telling you, I got a whole list of them. Some terrible choices. And I paid the price for it. And I had to pay the consequences. And you need to allow them to make those choices, where except where there's going to be great bodily injury, and let the consequences fall, and let them take the consequences. They must make the choice, and so encourage them to do so. This is what the scripture says in Joshua 24, verse 15. He said to them, the people, choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. Choose. You have to make a choice. It's your choice. I'm not going to force you. You have to make the choice. Proverbs 1:29, Solomon said, because they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord. There is a choice. Every person has to make it. And especially in the teen years, you have to allow them to make those choices. Now, that is basically how a child learns to be obedient. And it's all you can do to help them down that road. Now, the second responsibility is to honor you. Verse 2, honor your father and mother. What does it mean to honor? To honor your parents. Well, basically, it means a little different depending on your age, and because Some of us are adults, and we have adult parents who are much older than we are. Then we have children who are to honor us as their parents and as their mother and father. So how do you do this? I think this is a very confused concept today in the body of Christ. And so it bears addressing. The word here, to honor, literally means to treasure, to value, to respect. And so if a child is to honor his parents, then it means a younger child who is underage in your home, living under your roof, then that means to respect and to treasure you in love. For an adult living on their own, it still means you need to respect your parents. But in this case, it's not obey your parents. A younger child, it is respect and obey them. And obedience is a part of honoring your parents. But as an adult, it is, you have one more responsibility. You leave off the obedience part, but then you add another aspect to honoring your parents, which is helping them, especially when they are in physical need or when they are old. Now, you say, well, where do you get that, Steve? Well, let's look at a couple of verses. In 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 4, it says there, if any widow has children or grandchildren, let them first learn to show piety at home and to repay their parents. So true piety, true godliness, true respect for your parents or your grandparents would be to help them. And that's your first responsibility, is to them. In fact, the next verse says that if you do not do this, then you're worse than an unbeliever. Okay, so you need to take care of your parents. Now, in 1950s, 60 to 70% of all American homes had at least one grandparent living in the home. Today, according to our latest census, less than 1% of American homes have a grandparent living in the home. Now, that is a dramatic change. And why is that? Well, most likely because people are just shipped off to nursing homes. That is the reason. That is my view. I may be wrong, but that's what I think is the reason. And our generation today is much more self-oriented. And there is a great lack of respect for older people within our society today. You see, we don't care about children, and we don't care about old people. Those are the two parts of our society that get the least care for. That's the reality. And so it is essential. And it says in Leviticus 19, verse 32, it says, you shall rise before the gray-headed and honor the presence of an old man and fear your God. I am the Lord. Is that pretty clear? I mean, that's God's moral law. Very clear. Honor an older individual. And it says, rise when they come into the room. Boy, how many does that happen in your house? Do we do it with our own parents? Very important. Now, Paul quotes the fifth commandment here, which is quite interesting. He says, honor your father and mother, which is the fifth commandment, or first commandment, with promise. Now, he declares here it's the first commandment. Well, it's not the first commandment. It's the fifth commandment. So what does he mean here by the first commandment? Well, it's the first commandment in the six commands that are relating between men and other men. between people to people commandments. The first four are commandments that relate between man and God. But the last six deal with man in his relationship to other men. And so it is the first commandment. This word first means in rank and importance. In rank and importance. So it is the first commandment in rank and importance for you and your relationship to people. It's the way you treat your parents. That's pretty powerful. Now, this is, I think, something that I address with people all the time, and it's the way you live at home, the way you deal with your family members is a critical issue. Because the way I am at home is the real me. That's the real me. The way you are at home, when the doors are closed, that's the real you. It's not the person you are here at church. It's not the person you are when you've got a household of guests. It's the person you are in private. That's who you really are. And so he encourages them here. This is the first commandment in rank and importance for every single one of us. Now, he says here that it might be well with you on the earth. This comes from Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 16. You'll find some people will say, you know, the first time this particular commandment is given, it's not listed there in Exodus. Well, you just got to read the second giving of the law, and it's very clear it is there. And it says there in Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 16, honor your father and your mother as the Lord your God has commanded you, that your days may be long and that it may be well with you in the land which the Lord your God has given you. Now, what does he mean here that it might be well with you? Well, there's another commandment. I'll read that to you. It's in Leviticus 20, verse 9. It says, for everyone who curses his father and his mother shall surely be put to death. Well, that's what he means by it will be well with you if you honor your father and your mother. You won't end up getting stoned for cursing your mother or your father. It says in 1 Timothy 5:1, do not rebuke an older man, but exhort him as a father. Younger men as brothers. You see, all of these verses are teaching and training all of God's people, you know what, deal respectfully with older people and especially with your parents. And when you deal with this issue in your own home with your children, you say, well, how do I teach them to honor me? Well, here's two ways. The first is never allow them to speak disrespectfully to you or to others or about others. I believe that this is a critical thing that takes place many times in just regular conversation. It happens at your dinner table, at your breakfast table, it happens when you're driving in the car. It is disrespectful speech. Now, if you allow your children to be disrespectful verbally to you, I guarantee you their heart is not in the right place, which means that they aren't going to willingly obey you or respect what you have said out of your presence. So it is really critical to get at that issue. You know what? I don't hear a respectful attitude at the moment. What's going on? What's going on with you? What's going on in your heart? What are you upset about? Because obviously you're upset about something. So what is it? Now we're getting to the issue, the real issue. Well, I don't know. Yes, you know. What is it? Let's sit here, and we're going to sit here until we find out what it is. Because obviously, this is not going to be a very happy day if you've got this attitude towards me. So what are you upset with me about? Well, I didn't like you telling me I had to take the trash out.
Well, now we've got at it. Okay, the real issue in the heart here is rebellion. I don't want to be told to take the trash out. Well, I usually will then say, okay, well, you know what? We all have chores here in this family. I have my chores and you have your chores. And this is your chore. And this is your responsibility. And that's what a family is. So do you not love our family? Do you not love being a part of our family? Because that really is the issue, you see. You see, I don't want to have to do anything for you. That's really what they're saying. I don't want to serve you. I don't want to help you. Oh, I want you to help me. I want you to take me down to the movies this afternoon. I want you to take me to the beach tomorrow. But I don't want to do anything for you. Do you see? You have to get at that attitude. And if you don't get to that in the heart, you're missing the point. So you can't allow disrespectful, dishonoring speech to come your direction because it comes from a heart that is not in the right place. And so if I am commanded in 1 Timothy 5:1, as I've already read, do not rebuke an older man, but exhort him as a father. If I'm not even to rebuke an older man, but I'm to be very respectful when I speak to an older individual, then how much more should that be in your home with your children? Now, the last part of this in having and helping a child learn to honor you and to respect you is you, as a parent, must be an honorable individual and worthy of respect. Now, this is the other side of the coin, and I believe is just as important. You know, I do marriage counseling and I do family counseling, where we get the whole family together when there's major conflicts in the home. And I'm telling you, I can't tell you how many times the teenagers sit there and just say, you know what? I can sense that you don't respect your parents. What is up? And they go, well, you know what? They do this and they do that and they speak to me this way and they talk to me this way and they do this. And then they turn around and tell me not to do it after they did it. And I say to the parents when I get them back in there, I go, you know what? That doesn't flow. That doesn't make it. That is not going to work. If you want to have your children respect you, then you better be respectful to them. You better have a respectful attitude. That doesn't change the fact that you are in charge and you are asking them to do something. That's not disrespectful to ask them to do something or to ask them to heed your authority. But you have to do it in a respectful way. Are you an example in your own home? That's the bottom line. In Matthew chapter 23, verse 3, Jesus spoke to the disciples and he told them, he said, whatever the Pharisees tell you to do, he said, you do, you observe that observe and do, but do not do according to their works, for they say and do not do. In other words, they're not men of their word. They are hypocrites. They say one thing and they do another. And Jesus is telling the disciples, don't be like that. If you're like that, then you're nothing but a Pharisee. And again, there are a whole lot of Christian parents that are Pharisees because they're telling their kids, don't do this, don't do that, and they turn around and do it themselves. And it's not going to fly. And it will come back to bite you in the end, I guarantee you. You must be an honorable individual. You know, this is the way the people looked at Samuel the prophet. In 1 Samuel chapter 9, verse 6, referring to Samuel, they said, look now, there in this city is a man of God
And he is an honorable man. An honorable man. You see, he was known as an honorable man because of his example. Because of everything he did. He could stand up and say to the people, you know what? If one of you has a charge against me, state it now. If I have stolen one thing from you, if I have taken one thing that I shouldn't have had, if I have done you wrong in any way, you declare it now. That's pretty powerful. I think not only being an example, you have to exhibit love and respect to your children and the way you speak to them. Do you speak to them like they're the dog? Or do you speak to them like they're another human being? They're a Christian brother or sister, because that's what they are. It says in Proverbs 15:1, a soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. I'm telling you, you will stir up anger in your child if you speak in a harsh way to them. You have to speak the truth in love. Do you listen or do you only talk? You know, many times parents, they do all the talking and they do no listening. They don't listen. And that's not a respectful thing. If you want them to listen to you and not roll their eyes, then you need to listen and not to roll your eyes. You see, it's a two-way street, guys. It says in Proverbs 18:15, he who answers a matter before he hears it, it is folly and shame. And so if you start talking before you've heard your son or daughter lay it out, then it's folly and shame to you. Do you have rules without relationship? You see, real relationship is what it's all about. You have to have a real relationship. Now, this particular little formula is something that James Dobson gave, and I've never forgotten it. He said, rules without a relationship equal rebellion. You have to have rules and a relationship with your children. And then you most likely are not going to find the rebellion. Are you a fault finder without ever giving praise? This is another great mistake of parents. Fault finding without praise. I'm telling you, it's so easy for us to find the faults. Is it not? We can pick out all the faults. It's easy. But do you ever give them praise? It says in Psalm 72, verse 15, it says, their prayer also will be made for him continually, and daily he shall be praised. That's what David said. Daily he shall be praised. Now, that's what it's all about. I'm telling you, praise is just as important as correction and finding fault. Your responsibility is to correct the disobedience and the rebellion, but it's your responsibility to train and teach the right path. You have to do both. You have to correct and you have to praise. Now you say, well, I had one mom say to me, well, there isn't anything to praise this kid about. I go, well, I think you need to take another look. Think about, is there not one thing that this child did good today? Not one thing. Well, I'm not going to be a phony and just, you know, start praising him for no reason at all. There is a reason. I mean, they did their homework. Well, that's good. You did your homework. That was great. You know, and you praise them for whatever they do, and they do correctly. Now, do you like it when somebody thanks you and blesses you for something that you've done for them? Well, if you like it, then make sure you give it to your children. And then the last thing is the issue of showing partiality. Now, probably this is something that takes place in where you have all biological children and where you have a blended family. This occurs in both experiences, where one parent gets along better with one child
and then they don't get along so good with the other child. Have you ever had that experience? And one of you clicks with this one of you clicks with that one. And then all of a sudden, you're just a little more partial towards this one than you are towards this one. And I'm guaranteeing you, your children can pick that out just like that. They can see it. They know what fair is. And you better be fair. If you're not fair, then you're showing partiality. Now, does that bring conflict in a family? Oh boy, major. One of the best biblical examples of that, of course, is Jacob and Esau. And that conflict was simply because Isaac showed favor to one child over the other. And then we see that basically Jacob did the same thing. He favored Joseph over the other children. And what did Joseph's brothers do to him? Because daddy loves little Joseph more than he loves me. Well, we're going to get rid of this kid, and he's out of here. So it's major conflict. Partiality is sin. It's sin. And I'm telling you, it's hard. I'm not going to say it's easy. It is hard. It is difficult to show equality and no partiality. I'm telling you, it's difficult, but you have to do it. If you did it for this one, you got to do it for that one. And if you don't, then you're going to have a problem. So you have to think through what are your rules, what are your policies going to be, because you got to be equal with them. And you know, I'll tell you, it's an issue that it must happen. You must do it. And so I encourage you, don't be partial. It says in James chapter 2, verse 4, he told the people there in those days, he said, "Have you not shown partiality among yourselves?" And he said, "Become the judges of evil thoughts." You see, partiality is the result of evil thoughts. Your thinking is incorrect. When you have a blended family, you have even a greater problem with this. Or potential problem with it, because you have, well, those are your children and these are my children. I'll take care of my children, you take care of your children. Oh, that doesn't work, I guarantee you. Because when you have that issue, well, you just stay out. This is my daughter, this is my son, you don't have any say in this matter. Oh, baby, I'm telling you, you are destroying your marriage now. Because you're not showing partiality, nor are you showing submission to the headship of your own husband. I'm telling you, it's disaster. And so be very careful about this. You have to show equality and be equal with all children. And I'm telling you, if you're not, they will see it. So take these principles, and I pray you'll apply them in your own life and in your own family, because it will be well with you as well. Amen? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you tonight, Lord, because you are an awesome Father. And Lord, you have corrected us. You have trained us. You've disciplined us. You've instructed us in the right path. You've done it in a loving way. I mean, Jesus was one fantastic example of a leader, of what you as the Father are all about. Getting down at the feet of the disciples to wash their feet. Lord, what an example. Lord, help us as fathers to be that example. Help the moms here in our midst to be that example. Lord, we want to be that example of truth, of righteousness, of what it means to be honorable and worthy of respect. Lord, help us to live that way. And when we fail, Lord, we give us the grace to go back and ask forgiveness. Lord, we thank you that
Lord, there's humble pie to eat sometimes, but Lord, that's a good thing as well. That's a training in our own lives. And so, Lord, we just ask you to give us your grace to be the best parents we possibly can. And Lord, we commit our children into your hands. Lord, give them a heart after you, we pray, to follow you and obey you all of the days of their life. Lord, we believe you to do this, for we ask it in Jesus' name.
I want to thank you for watching our program. I trust that God has spoken to your heart. I believe that God is trying to reach you and help you resolve the problems in your marriage. But for those of you that have never made a commitment to Christ, your first step is to respond to God's invitation. Jesus said, "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Do you want his rest? Do you want his peace and his power? If you do, ask God to forgive you. Invite Christ into your heart, and he'll fill you with his Holy Spirit. If you do, God will radically change you, your life, and your marriage. For those of you that have already made a commitment to Christ, you're a Christian. I want to encourage you to identify where you're failing in your marriage and obey God's commands. Trust his promises. Open your heart to him. Do what he's told you to do. May the Lord richly bless your marriage.
You are the hand that catches my fall. You are the friend that answers my call. You are my day.